I think Buddhist Economics have something to say. What Fritz Schumacher started 40 years ago with his book, Small is Beautiful, was a good beginning. For him, Buddhist Economics mean right livelihood. Right livelihood means you don't exploit yourself, you don't exploit others. That's the key from Schumacher's point of view. And he also proposed appropriate technology. He said we are now controlled by the more complicated technology, the more we are under their mercy. And if we believe that technology can help to solve the world, that is, we are in danger. You may have heard what the disaster took place in Japan the year before last, because the Japanese are competing with the West with the latest technology. And that latest technology is now killing the Japanese. And yet mainstream politicians, economists in Japan feel that they can do better in my own country. Supposed to be a Buddhist country. And last year, big flood. And the top people, the mainstream people, politicians, economists, technicians, they said we can have better dam, better technology. But from the Buddhist point of view, that is hallucination. You can never control nature. Nature, in the Buddhist word, nature is born out of Dhamma. You can use the word Dhamma, you can use God if you wish, or you can use something sacred, something omniscient, something universal, something mysterious that we don't understand. But if you train your mind to be more humble, you train your mind to be less selfish, it's the chance to understand nature is much, much, much more so. I think what we need to learn in the Buddhist economic, first of all, learn to be humble. Learn to realize that other people are as important as we are. Or indeed, the more you think, respect other people, the more you're going to be a better human being. At the meeting in Berkeley, the Economics of Happiness, Helena Noble-Hodge, who started that movement some years ago, she wrote a book on ancient future. She said, future of the world is not New York, not Washington, D.C., but Ladakh, a very poor place, the poorest part of India. But the people in Ladakh are full of happiness. Nobody felt they were poor. By Western standards, they're very poor. They have very little. But they give so generously. They think that we are all interconnected. And not only that, they believe everyone is their mother. I went to Ladakh 20 years ago. They call me mother. Oh, I was so pleased at that time. My tummy was a little bit big. I thought I may deliver a baby anytime now. But they said, you must be serious. You are not my mother in this life. You may be my mother in the last life, if not the next life. Happiness when you regard somebody as your mother, that's happiness. Because your love to your mother and your mother love to you, it's essence of happiness. The Buddha said in the one of the well-known sutta, a mother willing to protect her child, her only child, by willing to sacrifice her own life for her child. Let all of us follow that mother, willing to sacrifice our life for all sentient beings. I think this is the gist of happiness. When you regard yourself less important, others are more important. And of course, Schumacher wrote Buddhist Economics as an outsider. He himself was brought up as an agnostic Protestant. He ended up becoming a Catholic, a very appropriate place to praise Schumacher. He became Catholic at the end of his life. But his contribution to Buddhist Economics is wonderful. From an outsider who's not practicing Buddhism, for those who practice Buddhism, Buddhist economic means, number one, be aware of greed, hate, and delusion in yourself. And to do that, you cannot use the Cartesian approach. Your head alone is not sufficient. You must cultivate your heart. You must realize it. What is the most important element in your life?